I've been working with polymers and composites my entire career now, so this is over 35 years. I started out actually with a degree in metallurgy and material science, but very quickly moved over to specialising in the non-metallic side of polymers and composite materials. I've been very lucky in working in a number of different areas, from research and development and academia through to characterising the mechanical performance of these materials. I spent some time working with finite element analysis in the simulation of composites and polymers structures and their behaviour. I also spent 10 years working in Japan in the automotive, renewable energy, marine and rail sector. In 2010, I returned to the UK, and since then I've been at TWI helping our members solve their problems with non-metallic materials and in particular joining of these materials. I've become the chair, I think, because for me it's an opportunity to use my knowledge and experience and the wide range of experience that I have in different industry sectors, in different characteristics of the materials, to try and help people become more aware of these relatively new materials and understand how sometimes they can be the right material, the right tool for a particular job. So to try and help people understand what these materials are and how to use them. The aim of the technical group is very similar actually. It's to make the Welding Institute members aware of these new materials. And when I say new materials, polymers and composites are the children of the materials selection tools. So compared to metals and ceramics, they haven't been around for a long time. Polymers, probably synthetic polymers, less than 100 years. Composites, fiber reinforced composites were first produced in the 1930s, carbon fiber in the 1960s. So compared to the long history we have with metals and ceramics and other materials, they're quite new, and there's still a lot of lack of understanding of these materials. They're seen as being a little bit special and scary maybe because of their unusual properties and the way they're made and the way the fibers are distributed in the composite certainly. So there's a little bit of uncertainty in how we use the materials. So the aim of the group is to make everybody aware of these types of materials, what they can be used for and what they can't be used for. So ultimately allow engineers and designers to select the right materials for the right jobs. Polymers are long chain materials. They can be naturally occurring or they can be synthetic. We're familiar with these in our everyday life. We're all aware of the plastic materials that we see in bags, carrier bags and packaging and films. But they're everywhere. We're not aware maybe of the pipes that transport gas and water to our houses. Traditionally these are made of polymers. They're also used in the oil and gas industry to transport more aggressive fluids. So these are, materials have been around for, I say, synthetic polymers, the early 1900s, 1920s, 1930s. The naturally occurring materials have been used for a couple of hundred years, but much lower performing. So polymers are the long chain molecules. Composites, that's maybe a little bit more difficult to define. Composites are generally recognized as being a combination of two or more materials that are brought together to create a new material that has properties which are better than the individual components. We're all familiar with composites in a lot of the baths that we use are made of composite materials. Wind turbine blades, Formula One racing cars, aeroplanes contain a high proportion of composite materials. We tend to think of composites as these more advanced materials, so carbon fiber reinforced epoxy, or glass fiber reinforced epoxy, or carbon fiber reinforced thermoplastics in the oil and gas industry. But the fiber and the matrix that are combined together to make the composite, they can be continuous fibers, they can be short fibers, they can be particulate fibers. And once you start combining different forms of different materials of reinforcement with different materials of the matrix to make our composite, then you can have almost an infinite number of combinations. Some people would argue that reinforced concrete was a composite material because we have steel fibers in a concrete matrix. So it really all depends on what particular application you're looking at. Are you looking at advanced composites in aerospace, or are you looking at the more commodity composites in some of the other applications? Where are composites used? Well, they're used almost everywhere. If you look around us today, you'll see applications of composites. You might not necessarily realize that they are composite. There may be short fiber composites in the electrical sockets or plugs that you see in kettles and irons, a lot of the components and equipment that we use. More and more these days, we're seeing them in cars. Probably the first widespread industrial use of composites in cars was the BMW i3. But they've been used in car bodies going back to the 1950s when Corvette first launched the glass fiber reinforced body of their vehicles. We see them in wind turbine blades everywhere. We see them in aeroplanes. We see them in sports equipment. We see them everywhere. We see them in transportation applications. Often we don't realize what they are. We see them in Formula One cars, obviously, because they're used for their high specific properties, their strength to weight ratio. Anywhere where we need something that is light because it needs to move quickly or it needs to be raised off the ground. Or we need something that has corrosion resistance because composites offer the potential for improved corrosion resistance compared to some metallic materials. Or it may be for their energy absorption, so crash structures use composite materials. Or it may be simply because we want the lightest, thinnest application we need. So they're all around us. We're very familiar with some of the applications, but others we're not so familiar with. I think if I was to summarize these into the two challenges, one really relates to how relatively new these materials are. They haven't been around for a long time, so we haven't had time to build up the knowledge and the properties of these materials. So whereas you could go out and find a lot of the mechanical properties, physical properties of metallic materials required for your design, it's more difficult with polymers and composites. We're still very immature in the test methods. So test methods for polymers and composites have been traditionally transposed from metallics and ceramics. But that's not necessarily the right way to go because the properties of these materials may demand different test methods, different test coupons, etc. And sometimes we just don't have the standards at all. We don't have very many standards for high rate testing of composite materials, which is essential for their use in aircraft and other applications where high speed impact is a problem. We also don't have some of the mechanical test standards for some of the new, relatively unusual type of composites, so 3D composites or 3D printed composites, or composite materials with unusual fiber orientations or fiber architecture. The standard test methods don't necessarily apply to these materials. And if we can't measure and have confidence in the mechanical properties of these materials, how are we supposed to use them efficiently and safely in applications? So I think that's one of the main challenges, to improve our understanding of these materials and find ways of measuring the properties so we're more confident in using them in applications. And I think the second challenge, this may be the greater challenge going forward, is recycling of these materials. We're all aware of the issues with recycling of plastics. Not necessarily because they're bad materials, but because of the bad things that we do with them and not taking care of them after they've come to the end of their life. Composites are facing a similar problem. Composites are being used more and more, which in a way is a good thing because we can exploit their properties. We can save energy, we can save fuel in aircraft, we can make things better. But if we can't recycle them or do something useful with them at the end of their life, we're just pushing the recycling problem further down the line for our next generation to deal with. And if we're not careful, composites are going to suffer because they will have another bad reputation, just like plastics can at the moment. So we need to think about what do we do with these materials at the end of life. And this needs to start now with research and development into ways of separating these materials at the end of their life, getting the fibers and the matrix separated So we bring them together to make the composite, which is the good use of their properties, but we now have to separate them and reuse those fibres and the matrix materials. So I think those are the two main challenges facing composites and polymers in the future.